Good morning and welcome to the 33rd meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Please ensure all mobile phones are on silent. And I welcome back for a brief visit Graeme Simpson, who's joining us for items 2 and 3. And just a reminder that broadcasting will operate your camera and microphone as usual. Please allow a short pause before being called on to speak to allow them to do so. Agenda item 1, we've consideration of whether to take agenda item 7 in private. Item 7 is consideration of the evidence heard today. The committee will also decide whether to take in private the work programme at our next meeting on Wednesday, 23rd of December. As we're meeting remotely, rather than asking whether everyone agrees, I will instead ask if anyone objects. To this silence, I will assume your content. Does anyone object? In that case, that is agreed. Thank you. Item 7 will be taken private, and we will consider the work programme at our next meeting on Wednesday, 23rd of December, in private. Agenda item 2, the committee will take evidence on two instruments, the Draft Housing Scotland Act 1987, Tolerable Standard, Extension of Criteria, Amendment Order 2020, and the Draft Housing Scotland Act 2006, Modification of the Pairing Standard, Amendment Regulations 2020. And I now welcome Kevin Stewart, Minister for Local Government, Housing and Planning, Katrina McKean, Deputy Director, Better Homes, and Simon Roberts, Team Leader, Housing Standards and Quality, and Rachel Nicholson, Solicitor, Housing Branch, Local Government and Economy Division, Scottish Government. We understand that these two instruments have the same common purpose, so we are taking evidence on them jointly, but they will be formally debated separately. These instruments are laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve them before the provisions can come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda items to consider the motions to approve the instruments. I remind everyone that the Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. And I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak to these two motions seeking approval for the Housing Scotland Act 1987, Tolerable Standard Extension of Criteria Amendment Order 2020, and the Housing Scotland Act 2006, Modification of the Repairing Standard Amendment Regulations 2020. With the committee's permission, Convener, I intend to speak to both instruments together, and if approved, these will postpone the requirement for all homes to meet new standards for smoke and heat alarms and carbon monoxide detectors to February 2022. Before I start, I'd like, first of all, to put on record my apology for what has happened here and for any anxiety or distress that folk have experienced, either as a result of the messaging that went out from private companies, either as a result of that messaging or from the failure of the Scottish Government to communicate our own messages as we had originally intended to progress this year. The misuse of our logo absolutely should never have happened, and in an ideal world, without the pandemic, we should have done more ourselves to get clear messages out there. There are lessons to be learned, and I assure the committee that we have learned them, and we will stop this situation or anything like it from happening again. As it currently stands, Convener, the changes relate to the requirement for all homes to have interlinked fire and carbon monoxide detectors situated in specific areas within the home and are due to come into force as is on 1st of February 2021. However, it is clear that the COVID pandemic has created difficulties for people seeking to install new fire and carbon monoxide alarms and has cut across our original plans for publicising the changes. We have listened to concerns and agree there is a strong case for a one-year delay to the legislation to allow people more time to carry out this important safety work. Improving fire safety, however, remains a key priority for the Scottish Government. These instruments do not change the substance of the new standard as it was considered by the committee at the previous meeting on the 19th of December 2018. And the basic principle that this standard will help to reduce the risk of death and injury has not changed. Although we plan to delay this to allow more time for people to fit alarms and to resume our plans to raise public awareness as we move through the pandemic situation, I would encourage homeowners, urge homeowners to install alarms to the new standard at the earliest opportunity, to not only ensure compliance with the regulations, but to ensure that occupants themselves live in a home which is as safe as it possibly can be. I'm requesting that the committee consider two related instruments, as during the course of preparing the amendment for the date for the tolerable standard, which affects all housing, it came to light that we would also require to change the date on which existing standard ceases to be part of the repairing standard for private landlords. This required an additional instrument because the power in Section 86(2) of the Housing Scotland Act 1987 is to amend the tolerable standard by order, but the power in Section 20A(1) of the Housing Scotland Act 2006 is to vary the repairing standard by regulations. To ensure that the duty on private landlords in relation to providing smoke and fire alarms and carbon monoxide alarms is not removed and aligns with the tolerable standard, the second instrument for the repairing standard is also required. Our combined efforts to minimise the various harms of this awful pandemic has required us to be flexible. I hope the committee will agree that it is right that we show that flexibility now and allow further time to raise awareness and give people the additional time and opportunity to fit the necessary alarms. If this delay is approved, we will resume and build on our work with partners to raise awareness of the changes for the new deadline. And we will also seek to work with suppliers and retailers to maximise effective support and advice to homeowners. As we know, convener, this standard is already clear for the private rented sector, and given the strides already made by landlords in the social rented sector, our focus will be on supporting householders to ensure satisfactory fire and carbon monoxide alarms are installed so that we can improve the safety of their homes. Although the delay will give people that further 12 months, as I've said, I do hope that most people will recognise its safety benefits and take action much sooner, and I have instructed my officials to explore all avenues to ensure this is as easy as possible for people to do. Scotland, as we already know, has rigorous standards for smoke and fire alarms. We know that the presence of working fire and smoke alarms significantly reduces casualties and fatalities within the home. One death from fire is one death too many, and we want to do all that we can to ensure that people are supported. I therefore ask the committee to support these motions in order to balance a proportionate response to the impacts of this pandemic with our ambition to improve fire safety in all Scottish homes. And I'm happy to take questions from members, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. We now move on to questions from members, and for information, if Graeme Simpson has any questions, I'll invite him to ask after committee members have the opportunity to ask theirs. I believe Andy has a question. Andy Whiteman.
Thanks very much, Convener. Thank you, Minister, for those open remarks. Can you explain, given that the committee approved this instrument in December 18 and Parliament passed it in 2019, what efforts were made to raise awareness of this between January 2019 and February 2020, when the pandemic hit?
Convener, legislation was highlighted in the media as it passed through Parliament. And as with all publicity campaigns, timing, of course, is a key factor. If you promote things too early, people will have forgotten the message by the time it comes into force. And it was always the plan to ramp up publicity and communications to the deadline. However, COVID-19 and the associated public health information have without doubt taken precedence over other marketing campaigns and have been at the forefront of all that the Scottish Government has done in terms of communications since the beginning of this year. And although we continued to work closely with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, I recognise that this could have been better supported and amplified with more intensive activity. But as I say, that would have been lost, I think, with everything else that has been going on during the course of this year. It's regrettable that that some of the stuff that we had planned has not been possible, but I believe that it was right that the pandemic response was our priority from March of this year.
Thanks, Minister. Do you understand that there's a confusion in the public mind between the understandable need to ensure that homes have got adequate fire detection equipment? I think most people regard that as an obvious thing that should be required. So that on the one hand, and the fact that this is being introduced as part of the arrangements around tolerable standards, which generally relate to having an indoor toilet, having enough insulation, things that make a home habitable, fit to live in, as it were, as opposed to a critical safety feature. And there's a lot of confusion about between those two things, because to be perfectly frank, there is no duty, as you know, on homeowners to fit these. It just means that if they're not fitted at whatever date the regulations come into force, that house will be below the tolerable standard. There are many houses below the tolerable standard. Will you reconsider how this duty is being framed in legislation?
Convener, I think that standard for fire alarms, minimum standard for fire alarms, through the tolerable standard defines what is expected for all homes. And I believe that this is a proportionate measure. You know, we use many vehicles in terms of secondary legislation to enact regulation. I'm more than willing to have a discussion with the committee and with Mr. Whiteman in particular around about how he may want to see this done in future. But this is the legislative vehicle that we can use to bring this into play. And I think that we have all put an importance on fire safety. And I think that in using the tolerable and repairing standard, that is the right thing to do. But as I say, I'm willing to have further conversation with Mr. Whiteman and the committee around about this. But in terms of what we are doing here today, we have used the tolerable and repairing standard as that vehicle, and I would urge the committee to back the motions that are put forward, will be put forward later on in the committee session.
And just finally, the order just states that you need to have satisfactory equipment in place. It doesn't define what that is. That's defined in the guidance. And much of the concern that I think many of us had from constituents is that they think that what's being required in the guidance is rather over elaborate. Would you not agree that having something fitted, even though it's below that standard, is better than having nothing, and that that standard should be something to be achieved over perhaps a longer period of time rather than something that needs to be achieved by a set date just a year from now?
I would say that something is better than nothing, but you know, the committee agreed at the tail end of 2018 that we had to make on this to ensure that we were providing the most rigorous standards for smoke and fire alarms that we possibly could. As Mr. Whiteman and the committee are aware, these standards are already in place in the private rented sector. The social rented sector are working through these standards at this moment in time. And I think I said, if I remember rightly, to the committee at that point, that really in many of the things that we do, we should be taking an all-tenure approach, which includes owner-occupiers too. And I think we must ensure that people are protecting their two main assets, and that is their lives and their homes. And I think that you know, what we have here with these more advanced systems will do that. We know that in many other cases, some of the other alarms that have been used in the past, you know, where there is no interlinking, have caused difficulties. We know that some folk have not checked batteries and previous fire and smoke alarms that they have had. This provides greater protection, and that is what I thought we were all about here, particularly in light of what happened after the Grenfell tragedy, of which the committee has had a fair amount of discussion over the piece. And I would reiterate the point that this is already the standard in the private rented sector, that the social rented sector are aspiring to meet that standard. And I think that that standard should be the same right across all tenures, including owner-occupied homes.
OK, thank you for that. Sarah, you wanted to come in?
Yes, convener. Good morning, Minister. Can you say a bit more about what happened in 2019 after the after the SSIs were passed, and can you tell us how many installations were actually carried out in 2019, and how many Scottish homes still need these alarms installed to meet the guidelines?
Convener, I don't have those figures in front of me. If we can ascertain those figures, I'm more than happy to write to the committee around about that. What I would say to Ms Boyack is that all homes within the private rented sector should have these. And I know that within the social sector, as Ms Boyack will know from her previous work, you know, housing associations and councils are aspiring to ensure that these alarms, these new alarms are in place.
Yes, very much aware of that work. And it's really important, as you say, because of the Grenfell fire legacy. Do we know how many Scottish homes still need alarms installed to meet the guidelines in the private ownership sector? And can you tell us, Minister, what meetings you've held with local authorities in COSLA to discuss the implementation of the legislation, given the importance of local authorities in monitoring the tolerable standard? You say in your letter that you expect local authorities to make all use of their discretionary powers to offer appropriate support. So can you tell us what progress was made in terms of local authorities' discretionary powers being used in 2019 and then in early 2020?
I would expect local authorities to use their discretionary powers in many areas of business, and they do that, as Sarah Boyack knows. In terms of discussions with local authorities and others, you know, we are in continuous discussion all of the time with local authorities on many, many issues. If I can maybe hand over to Katrina, who is on the line, convener, she will be able to give you more specifics around about some of the discussions that took place on the run-up before implementing or bringing forward these regulations in the first instance, and what has gone on since. I would say, convener, that while there has been continued discussions throughout with SFRS, the discussions on this particular issue with COSLA may not have been at the top of our agenda during the course of this pandemic. But Katrina McKean will fill in the committee with some more of the detail, if that's okay, convener.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our focus for discussions has been around the fire service as a trusted source of information, advice and direct support to households, particularly those at highest risk of fire. Discussions with local authorities during my time in this role has absolutely been about understanding the impact of the pandemic on plans, in terms of how we could continue to progress safely with the restrictions in place, but then an increasing understanding that there were barriers facing people across local areas, including owner occupiers, in terms of getting the new alarms installed. The conversations going forwards with local authorities in terms of how we can make this as easy as possible for homeowners to make the changes, to access the right advice, to be signposted onto services available, and to make this as easy as possible is going to be our focus going forwards.
Yeah.
Okay. Sarah? Can I come in again? Thanks, convener. I think that's very helpful. I suppose I was very keen to find out what happened after the Parliament passed the legislation last time, because of the importance of local authorities, not just in terms of monitoring the tolerable standard, but those packages of support, which was mentioned in the committee evidence in December 2018. Minister, given the letter you sent us on the 11th of December, how many homes do you expect will have these installations before summer 2021, as we'll still be seeing the health and social impact of the pandemic for some time? February 2021. Doesn't that give us quite a challenge in the same way that we were with only a few months to catch up? So if the new deadline is going to be 2022, and we've got the pandemic lasting through quite a chunk of 2021, doesn't that give you quite a tight timescale for local authorities and suppliers, and the whole communications that clearly was quite challenging in the first attempt to roll out these programmes?
Convener, I didn't catch the beginning of Ms Boyack's question as she froze. I don't know if that was the same for everyone. If she wants to repeat the first part again, I'd be grateful.
Yeah, thank you for that, Minister. It was basically to ask, given the letter you sent us on the 11th of December, how many homes do you think we will have installations before before February 2022, because when we move into 2021, I think there's a strong expectation that the health and social impact of the pandemic will be with us for some time, and particularly older people or people who need to self-isolate. It's going to be challenging for them but the minister's now frozen. It will be challenging for them to get the access to the advice and the finance to get on and make these important improvements to their houses.
First of all, convener, as I've said, I would urge everyone who can do this to do it as soon as possible in order that they make their homes as safe as possible. What I would say to Ms Boyack, obviously, as we move forward, we will be keeping a very close eye on how all of this pans out. We are already looking at what marketing needs to be done in terms of getting the information out there. And beyond that, we are in continued discussions with SFRS around about how we support the most vulnerable people who may have difficulties in terms of installation or even cost. And one of the things which officials are looking at with others is how can we reduce cost for those folks who are in the category of not being able to afford the situation. However, also I've had situations whereby folk have said, why should we spend our money on this? Well, as I pointed out, it is about protection of the two greatest assets, their lives and their house. And I would expect that folk, if they can afford, to move forward on that front. I can assure the committee, and I'm quite sure that the committee itself will keep a close eye on this, I can assure the committee that we'll give regular updates on what we're actually doing in that front and how things are rolling out That we can all scrutinise this to the degree that I'm sure that some folk in the committee would want to. It is important that we get this right. I don't think that a further delay would necessarily be beneficial. And what we have to balance here, without a doubt, is the safety of folk and recognising, the situation that we currently find ourselves in as we come out of the pandemic period. So the committee can be assured that I'll be scrutinising this. I'm sure you will be too. I give the assurance that we'll continue to keep folk up to date of how we're getting on as we move forward.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Thank you, Sarah. Can I just say, before I bring in Alexander and then Keith, I think maybe part of what Sarah was asking was if we were struggling last year during the pandemic, what assurances can we have that that we won't hit the same problems this year in the run up to 2022?
Convener, I don't think we were struggling last year. I think the thing is that, as I said earlier, you know, timing is everything when it comes to marketing these things and moving things forward. And the marketing experts, of which I am not one, say it is always best to leave these things until later so that folk don't lose sight of them. Now, I would say that as it stands, probably for the wrong reasons, there is a greater awareness of this change now than there has been. We should take the positive from that and build on that and continue to deal with that as we move forward and take advantage of what is a not particularly brilliant situation. And keep getting the messaging out there, what is required here, why we are doing this for people's safety, and beyond that, to ensure that people know what the right systems are that needs to be installed and the reasoning for doing so. Convener, I've said we already have this standard in the private rented sector. We already see the social sector moving forward in installation. We need to do the same in the owner-occupied sector. Far too often, and I've said this to the committee before, in the past, governments and Parliament have legislated for particular sectors at different times. We should get away from doing that and take an all-tenure approach where that is possible, particularly when it comes to safety. The committee, as well as myself, I think were quite adamant a while back around about ensuring that we raise safety standards. This is what we want to do here. We have had cooperation with David Stewart in recent times around about proposals about fire suppression systems, which the government has moved forward on as well. And I want to continue to keep a close eye on all safety measures and to create standards which are the highest possible to protect people right across the country. Because as I said previously, one death from a fire is one death too many.
Okay, thank you. Alexander, and then Keith.
Thank you, convener. I welcome the minister's acknowledgement that the Scottish Government dropped the baton for this, because we wanted, when the committee made these representations in the past, we were all assured that there would be a strong awareness campaign, and we acknowledge that that has failed. And we now find ourselves in the situation of having to extend the programme to ensure that we can ensure that the community find themselves now positioned to move forward and to have these standards. And we acknowledge that these standards need to be put in place. So my question to the minister would be, where in the process do we have a discussion to ensure that the devices that are being thought, are being suggested, that will be fitted, is there a clear advice and approved process for that to ensure that the public at large are given as much information as possible to ensure that they can install and have these fitted at their homes to enhance their safety procedures?
Convener, there's a wee bit of a breakup there again, but I think just of Mr. Stewart's question, and if I miss anything out, I'm sure he'll come back. I think in terms of the equipment that needs to be installed, we have got on the Scottish Government website the details of the requirements, and I would ask folks to ensure that their constituents are directed to that. Beyond that, that is one of the key things that needs to happen in terms of the marketing campaign as we move forward, in terms of making sure that people know exactly what is suitable and what is not. In terms of installation, some of these systems can be fitted by householders themselves in terms of the interlinked battery systems. Requiring hard wiring, of course, may require an electrician. I've been pointed that I didn't answer part of Ms. Boyack's questions in a text around about guidance for allowing that work to go on. That can actually happen now, as long as folk are ensuring that they have the right PPE, social distancing, and all of that guidance again is in the Scottish Government website. And beyond that, I'd like to thank the Construction Industry Corona Virus Forum, who have been absolutely fantastic in communicating messages to householders around about what can and cannot happen in terms of works to keep everybody safe. So a key element of this, as I say, is in terms of the marketing, is ensuring that folk are directed to what the required devices actually are. And I hope that I picked up everything that Mr. Stewart asked there.
Thank you, Alexander. Can I also ask about the potential here, because we have a number of vulnerable individuals who are elderly and require this to be provided, is there a mechanism put in place to protect some of these vulnerable individuals from rogue traders or scammers who may see this as an opportunity to exploit these individuals?
As Mr. Stewart knows, because we've had discussions about this previously, I would want to do everything possible to ensure that scammers do not put the fear in people and do not con them out of money. We will keep a very, very close eye on all that is going on here, and I'm sure that individual members will do so too. We will also, as always, ask partners, including the likes of Age Scotland and others, to alert us to anything that they think that's happening out there that is untoward, letting us know about that so that we can deal with that accordingly. My message to the more vulnerable folk out there, to older folk and to organisations that are dealing with the public, is that the best way of seeking advice here is through the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, through the likes of Citizens Advice Scotland, and not to necessarily take advice from leaflets that may pop through your door or cold callers that come to your door, to seek the advice from the trusted sources, not the leaflets through the doors or the cold callers.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Keith?
Thanks, convener. Two quick questions, if I could. First of all, to say that I am more than happy to acknowledge that COVID and the pandemic has an impact on all sorts of government business, not just the obvious stuff, and I have to understand that. However, is it the intention, I wonder if the minister can say, that it would be roughly, given what he said about the crucial timing of the marketing, that we'd expect to have the legitimate government marketing around about the same time as we got the less legitimate, if you like, marketing from people this year? My concern is if it happens, and I understand why it should happen as close to the event as possible, in the kind of run-up to Christmas period, with a deadline in January or whatever it was, then it's not a great time to get folk to either lay out for that kind of expenditure or put additional, if you like, requirements on them at that time of year. Is that what's intended?
Not necessarily, convener. There are still discussions going on around about how we deal with the marketing campaign. As I say, I am not a marketing professional or expert in any way, shape or form. And I think we have to take the relevant advice from those that have the experience of all of this. I don't necessarily think that it will happen around about the same time as the leaflet. It's likely to be before. But as Mr. Brown and others are well aware, what we have to also do is make sure that that messaging doesn't get lost with other messaging at a future point in time. As I've said previously to the committee, I will be keeping, as you could well imagine, a very close eye on this as we move forward. I think the same would go for whoever may be sitting in this chair after the election. What we will do, convener, is continue to keep the committee informed throughout the process, so folks know exactly what is happening. Beyond that, convener, what I would say to all members is that it's not just about the marketing campaign either. We all have the opportunity to speak to folk on a regular basis. And I will ensure that all members of Parliament, as we move forward, are communicated with around about this issue, because I know that a number of folk have had correspondence on this particular matter.
Thank you.
Keith? Yeah, thank you, the Minister, for that. And just say it's a very useful suggestion, because we can all put this into annual reports to get this kind of information out there. We all have that ability as MSPs. But given what the Minister said previously to people to say, do it now, is he confident that people will be aware of what they have to do, what the standard is, and how they can go about it without getting ripped off if they do it now in advance of that marketing campaign?
Convener, as I said earlier, we have on the Scottish Government website all of the detail of what folks should be looking for in order that they are not, as Mr. Brown put it, ripped off. What we can do, again, is to highlight all of this to all members of Parliament and use your good offices to get that message across to folk who may have already been in touch with you on this particular issue. I am more than happy to keep members appraised of exactly what is going on and to provide the information that is required so that you can inform your constituents of what is required of them. As I said, and Mr. Brown has just mentioned it there, I would urge folk who can to do this as soon as possible. It does make them safer, protects them in their own homes, and I think that that is a good thing.
Thank you.
Right, thank you, Keith. Graham Simpson, do you have any questions?
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and hello to everyone. It's good to be back at the committee, and good morning, Minister. I do have a few questions. I've got to be honest, I'm a little bit confused here, and it goes back to the question that Andy Whiteman asked at the start about where the various responsibilities lie. The Minister wrote to the committee over the 20th, and he said, I'll just quote from the letter, "As with other housing standards, it will be the responsibility of the homeowner to meet the new fire and carbon monoxide alarm standard. However, it should be noted that the legislation does not create a direct duty on homeowners. The legal duty rests with the local authority to ensure homes in its areas are meeting the standards. Homes that don't have the right alarms will not be meeting safety standards, but nobody will be breaking the law if they're not able to comply." So, you know, you have a duty to do something, but you won't be breaking the law if you don't do it. And actually, the legal duty rests with the local authority. That is utterly confusing. So who actually is responsible for this? Is it the homeowner or is it the council?
Convener, whilst the legislation does not create a direct duty on homeowner, in practice, it will be the responsibility of homeowners to meet the new standard. As local authorities are required to have a strategy for ensuring compliance with the tolerable standard within a reasonable period, they have a wide range of discretionary powers to assist homeowners with these and other matters, and where necessary and appropriate, to require homeowners carry out work to improve substandard homes. However, I would expect local authorities to be proportionate in anything that they do here. The aim of housing standards is to improve houses, not to criminalise homeowners. So it's right, I think, that the new standards for fire alarms should be built into the tolerable standard, as improvement to fire safety should be part of, I think, the basic requirements on all tenures to improve that fire safety. So, you know, our aim here is to work in partnership with people as we move forward to get them to recognise that this is the right thing to do to protect their lives and their homes. But it is not an attempt to criminalise people. It is a regulation to encourage folk to play their part in getting this absolutely right.
So, thank you. In that case, do people not have to be scared that they're going to be breaking the law if they don't have these devices fitted? Is that the case, Mr.?
No, I don't want to put the fear in anyone here. What we need to do is we all need to encourage people to ensure that they recognise that these alarms are of benefit. Now, when it comes to a situation whereby someone chooses not to do that, local authorities have the discretion, have the power to say that they are not meeting that standard, but I would expect responses to be proportionate. Also, convener, of course, those standards will have to be met if somebody is trying to sell their home, so that it is absolutely in their interest to get this done. You know, I think that everyone recognises that in all that we do here, we have to be proportionate. We don't want to criminalise people, but we do want to ensure that folks do meet this standard, because it is best for them, it is best for their neighbours, it is best for their communities. One death from a fire, as I've said previously, is one too many, and I think that we can do a great deal here in helping reduce risk by ensuring that everyone across all tenures adheres to this standard.
Now, I, like many people, got the leaflet from a company, I think it's pronounced AICO, A-I-C-O, with the Scottish Government logo on it, and you've explained that shouldn't have happened. Of course it shouldn't. But if you go onto their website, and you can go onto it today, the message there is, you must comply to the new legislation by February 2021. Of course, that's the date that exists at the moment, but you must comply. So that is aimed at homeowners, and you're saying, Minister, that people will not be criminalised. Do you think that message from this company is too severe?
I would say that the message from the company is not a message that the Scottish Government would have related to people. I don't want anyone to be in fear from any message that is put forward. Can I say to the committee that in terms of the leaflet that went out and the situation that arose there, it would be fair to say that I was not a happy bunny about that. Raging could be a term that was used when I first caught sight of that leaflet. The words on that leaflet, I think, as Mr. Simpson pointed out, were designed to instill fear, which I don't think is beneficial. Can I just repeat around about that leaflet itself and the part that officials played in it? They did not follow proper procedure. It was a mistake, following which I've sought and been given assurance that lessons have been learned and that this will not happen again. It did not have ministerial approval, and it should have been signed off by ministers, but it was not. And you know, I can see, appreciate why some folk out there thought that the use of the Scottish Government logo could be seen as us endorsing products. That is not the case either. We do not endorse any products or services. Had ministers been consulted about all of this, which is what should have happened, I would have not approved that partnership or that messaging that went out, because I do feel that the tone was very, very wrong, and that it frightened people unnecessarily. So I hope that that answers my view on that to Mr. Simpson, and what I think was a very important question.
Okay, thank you. Can I have one more question?
Thank you very much for that. Okay, we now move on to agenda item 3, which is a formal consideration of motion S5M23439, calling for this committee to recommend approval of the Draft Housing Scotland Act 1987 tolerable standard extension of criteria, Amendment Order 2020, which we've just taken evidence on. I invite the Minister to move the motion and do anything for that.
You broke up towards the end there, Convener, but I'll formally move the motion.
And have you anything further to add?
Nothing further to add, Convener.
Thank you. I believe Andy Whiteman has a question. Andy?
Thanks very much, convener. Not so much a question, just a contribution to the debate. That's been a useful question from the Minister. I'm pleased that he has apologised for a failure. Government should do that more often. It's not a difficult thing to do, and it's appreciated, I think. This does, I think, as the Minister acknowledged, cause a little bit of difficulty to homeowners in understanding what is required. There is an impression out there that this is an obligation on homeowners to make their homes safe by putting these fire and heat installations in place. In reality, in law, failure to do so has no consequences for the homeowner. It merely means that their home will fall below the tolerable standard. And I think homeowners have a difficulty in understanding the difference between those two perspectives. That's not hard for the rented sector, because they have a duty of care towards tenants. I'm reassured that the Minister is intending to keep the committee appraised of progress over the next 14 months as well. And I would assume that as part of that assurance, if it were to be determined that perhaps more time were to be needed, and the deadline should be extended beyond February 2022, that the Minister would consider that. I was originally of the view that we need to give this a new, fresh reset of 2 years. I think, given the assurances that the Minister has provided to the committee, I'm content to vote for this regulation. But as he's well aware, given the reassurances we sought last time that were not delivered for whatever reason, we will be keeping a very, very close eye on this and appreciate the Minister's commitment to keep the committee informed as to the progress towards ensuring a better public information on this, and particularly a better understanding in the public mind as to exactly what their duties and responsibilities are. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Andy. Sarah, and then Alexander.
Thanks very much, James. I was actually listening to Andy. I was actually quite disappointed with the Minister's comments, and I mean, very much welcomed the apology he started off with. But fundamentally, there hasn't been a campaign to give people the information that they need. I mean, if you go to look at the website, as the Minister suggested, if you were then going to install this equipment, it's not straightforward. There's a real issue about retailers having that information in shops so that people know what they need to buy. And I genuinely don't think that the extension of 1 year is going to be enough for this. I do think it's going to need 2 years, because by the time we get through the pandemic, we are looking into next summer. And the Minister talked about the need for decent comms strategy, and that you needed to do it near the time when you need to get people engaged. But surely we need an ongoing comms strategy, because you do not want everybody trying to get this installed, as Keith Brown said, in the run-up to Christmas next year. This has got to be something that people do throughout the year. If people are moving homes, which they're doing all the time, even through the pandemic, there's no publicity about this. And that would be a very good time, as the Minister said, to actually get this kit installed. So I don't think this is a one-off publicity drive we need. You need political leadership here at the Scottish Government level and at local government level as well. And I just don't see that there's been any of that in the last 2 years. So it's really, really important that this is given much higher priority, because the opening points the Minister made about fire safety are absolutely bang on. This is critical to people. So we need to give people enough time to do it, to take into account the comments that Graeme Simpson made. But we also really need to make sure that there's a proper process here. And that's about installers. It's not about a one-off leaflet. It's also about retailers, because if the idea is that many people can go and get this installed themselves and they can do it themselves, you need to know that when you go and buy the equipment, that you are buying the right equipment. And that's just not the case now. I think the other thing that is really important is consistent campaign that works with all the different stakeholders, like the SFRS, local authorities, all the consumer groups that have been mentioned, but also a raft of support organisations, because even if this kit is relatively straightforward, there are going to be many people that can't reach their ceilings, people who live in tenements, people who've got disabilities, older people. They are going to need suppliers to help them install this. So this needs to be done properly. It's not going to be something that takes a couple of months. I think to get the equipment out there, if you go around the shops, if we all went out and bought this stuff tomorrow, the supplies aren't there, so there's a supplier issue as well. So I think this needs a real strategy. I do welcome the fact the minister is going to come back to the committee on a regular basis, but I think what we need is a strategy for implementation here. It's not just a publicity campaign. There's so much more in terms of the logistics that really needs to be thought through, because this is important for everybody. And it is about your property, it's about your life, but it's also about making sure we can get this done for people, and that they get the support. And I think there are clearly lessons to be learned, but I don't think this is a one-off publicity campaign. I think it's got to be much more than that. And I really think that people need more time than just resetting the dial till 1 year. I think you need to look at 2 years, Minister. I know you're not looking very happy at my comments, but I would much prefer that we had that ingrained now with a proper timing and a campaign, because I just think for a lot of people, the headspace, the health concerns, and just the sheer money, people who a year ago would be, they wouldn't see £200 as being an obstacle. There's the number of people that have lost their jobs in the last year before we even get through the pandemic. So I think a lot more needs to be done in this. And personally, I would like to see a 2 year implementation process. I think it'd be more realistic. And I think it would actually help all those involved to make this work in practice, so we're not back here next year saying it's not quite done. And the fact we don't even know how many homes need to be done, because if you're supplying the equipment, how much equipment do we need in Scotland? Is the industry geared up? Are the installers geared up? There's an awful lot needs to be done here. And I think it needs that leadership strategy, and then it needs to be rolled out. And I just don't see that happening over the next 6 months as we run into the election. And then we're back to where we were last summer. So I can see you looking at me, convener, so okay. I'll wind up there and I'll take that hint. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Alexander, and then Keith.
Thank you, convener. I do acknowledge the minister today has indicated the Scottish Government were embarrassed by this whole process, and I think that is right, that they have today come and made an apology because of the difficulties that were identified. I hear what the minister has said, and I acknowledge that lessons are to be learned. But I also hear what Sarah Boyack is saying today about the need to have a stringent campaign, a campaign that raises awareness, not just at one occasion or one time, that it has a strategy, that it has a purpose to ensure. And, you know, charities have made some voices about this. Age Scotland's made some very strong recommendations. We've all received information from them. We know ourselves from the mailbag that we had when this whole situation occurred, when that leaflet went through doors, and the difficulties that were created because of it. And, you know, Mr. Wightman made some strong views about the standard and making sure that that things are there. So I have some real sympathy, convener, with the views of Sarah Boyack today about ensuring that it is extended further than just 1 year, because I do believe that that gives the opportunity, it gives local authorities, COSLA, the chance to manage this. We know that there will be a financial implication here. We know that vulnerable people would be put in some difficult situations, and there may need to be specific campaigns identified for specific home users and individuals themselves. So I, as I say, I acknowledge what the minister said today, but I, like Sarah Boyack, I don't believe it goes far enough ensuring that we will have the seamless transition that is hoped to have that we would have this in place by 2021. And I say, I think that there is merit in extending it for a further year.
Keith, thank you, Alexander. Keith?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to say that I think talk of embarrassment and things like that is a bit tedious, really. I think we all know that COVID has impacted everybody. We obviously make allowances for all sorts of people, citizens and others, because of what COVID's done to people's work programmes and lives, and I think that's equally true of the government. So I am more than willing to acknowledge the impact that COVID and the pandemic has had on the government in this, and I congratulate the Minister on being upfront about that. I do think that it's also true this is a good thing to do. And the idea of delaying it for a year, a further year, because of the safety that's inherent in the proposal, I wouldn't be supportive of. I think this has to be done as quickly as practically possible. It is a good thing. We all support it. So the idea of delaying it for 2 years, I don't think, unless it absolutely has to be, is the right thing to do. However, Sarah Boyack's points and others, I think, are quite important in terms of the way the campaign, the marketing campaign, is undertaken. I'm particularly thinking about, we talked about owner-occupiers. Now, a lot of owner-occupiers are older people on fixed incomes, including sometimes pensions. This is a big item for many of them, and they will be uncertain as to where to source the right supplies at the right price and also of the right standard. And I think it's probably going to have to be the case that this happens over a period of time. I don't think it can be left, notwithstanding the point the Minister made, which I understand, to say the later or closer to the event that you do this, the more likelihood it is of registering. I think it's going to have to be a series of hits. And to achieve what the Minister himself said he wants to do, which is the early take-up of this, I think it probably has to be done over a sustained period. And I think the suggestion made by the Minister that this could be done in conjunction with MSPs putting it in their annual reports, or maybe that was my suggestion, but it was from his kind of initiative. Also, MPs and councillors as well, we could all be part of this. I think that's very important. So I would support this. I don't think a delay is in the public safety interest. And I think it's important to get on and do this. But we take people with us, and in particular, we bear in mind those that are older people, that are on fixed incomes, and that want the right information about how to go about this correctly. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Keith. Graham, you wanted to come in briefly?
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I've listened with interest to the views of members there, and I am of the view that this is still a bit confused. And I take Sarah Boyack's point on board that when you actually go into shops and if you're trying to buy these products, it's actually not. It's not easy. It's not easy to find what is required. It's not easy to know what it is you're meant to buy. And I think the point that Keith Brown made at the very start about the date of February 2022 could potentially be clashing with that Christmas period, I think is a very good point. So I would be minded to support a delay. It doesn't have to be a further year. The only way the committee can go today, seems to me, is the committee either rejects what's in front of it, if it supports a delay, and the minister can go away and come back with a revised date, or the minister just agrees not to press and to come back to the committee. Because I think it's important that everyone's on board with this. Basically, everyone is. Everyone supports doing something. It is a matter of getting it right. And my concern is that timescale that the minister's suggesting is a little bit too tight, and it needs to be pushed back a bit so that we can get it right. It needs to be done correctly. It wasn't done correctly, as the minister's acknowledged to his credit. But it needs to be done correctly, and I would just urge the minister to think again and to work with the committee as it is now, and the committee as it will be after the Scottish elections. So it maybe just needs a rethink. Press the pause button. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Graham. Okay, Minister, before I let you back in, can I just clarify, excuse me, if we go for this deadline of February 2022 and there's people haven't achieved what they were asked to achieve by that time, there's no sanction on them, there'll just be encouragement for them to try and get it done as quickly as possible. I've got to raise you because I think that my idea that what you do is you then put it back to a point where you still have that end rush. February is a February, and that didn't seem to meet with the issues that February 22 appears to be meeting with just now. And on that note, Minister, I'll give you the opportunity to sum up and respond to the points made in the debate.
Convener, I had great difficulty in hearing what you said in your last points because you were breaking up quite badly. So I didn't get the gist of that at all, I'm afraid. So I don't know if you want to repeat that.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Right, okay. The point I was making was that if somebody hasn't achieved what they've been asked to achieve by February 22, there'll be no sanction on them as such. There would just be support and encouragement to get it done as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
That'd be right.
Convener, no sanction. Any response in this, as I say, has to be proportional. No sanction, but we need to encourage folk to do this. I've listened to the points around about a further delay. Let me cover that point first, because when we introduced the new fire and smoke alarm legislation in 2018, I took account then of feedback received by stakeholders and agreed to that 2-year lead-in time before the regulations would come into force. The primary purpose of an extension here for another year is to improve that protection from fire in people's own home. And as with many issues that have arisen because of the pandemic, we have to consider the balance of harms here. And I think I've responded flexibly in seeking the right balance, but an even further delay, I don't think is the right thing to do. The delay itself that we're asking for will give folk another 12 months to install the alarms, and I hope that most people recognise, and I think they do, the safety benefits of doing this and taking these actions now. And I've asked my officials to explore all avenues to ensure that all of this is as easy as possible for people to do. Now, much of the discussion this morning has centred around the marketing campaign. But Sarah Boyack is right. There are other aspects of this that we need to get right in terms of the strategy. And that's why we have had fairly substantial discussions, ongoing discussions, with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service around about the part that they have to play in helping us get all of this absolutely right. We have put in place and are discussing practical plans with the SFRS to help us restart our plans for awareness, but also ensuring that the messaging that they have thought is similar, but also helping them with practical things, for example, in terms of the installation that they will be carrying out in the homes of some of our most vulnerable people. You know, we have helped them in terms of the provision of ladders to be able to do that. The fire service has lots of ladders on vehicles, but you know, we have helped in that regard. And it is about, you know, the practical implementation as well. It is not just about the marketing strategy. And I'm quite happy to come back to the committee and to keep you informed on a regular basis by writing around about how we are getting on with all of that. Now, I think that there are key points around about retailers and getting the messaging right through retailers. We are looking at that too. I kind of find the place in the briefing for this, but again, we will let the committee know how we intend to move forward on that front as well. We have to be careful in all of that, convener, because as I said earlier, we don't want to endorse individual manufacturers or products, because I think folk would think that's wrong. However, there is a happy medium, I think, that we can find in terms of getting that absolutely right as well. But again, you know, I'm happy in terms of not only the marketing, but the other strategic points that have to be made, and in terms of our ongoing discussions with all partners to keep the committee appraised. As I say, this is about balance and getting it right. I'm sorry that we didn't get that right, but as Mr. Brown points out, you know, the pandemic has put a stop to many things that we aspired to do over the past number of months. And I hope that as we move forward, you know, we can get back to some kind of normality, not only on this front, but on many other areas of government, which we have had to pause because we have had to deal with the pandemic situation. Convener, I would urge the committee to support both motions that I will move today, and you can be assured that not only will I be scrutinising this very carefully indeed, but I will ensure that you have the opportunity to do so too, in order that we get it right for the people out there.
Thank you very much, Minister. In that case, the question is motion S5M23439, in the name of the Minister for Local Government, Housing and Planning, be approved. Are we all agreed? No? Okay. Therefore, we will have a roll call. Sarah Boyack?
Yes, no, I'm not voting. No, I do want to accelerate this stuff, though.
Keith?
Yeah, I don't want to see a delay in a vital public safety measure, so I'll vote with vote for the measures.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. I will vote with the government and let's get this through and support it and roll it out across the country.
Thank you. Annie Wells.
Thanks, Convener. I will vote again for the same reasons as Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Annie. Alexander?
Thank you, Convener. I would also vote against for the reasons that have been expressed by myself and Sarah Boyack.
Okay, thank you. Andy?
Thanks, Convener. Just to confirm, we're voting on motion S5M23439, which comes at item 4 in the agenda rather than item 3. Is that correct?
Yes, 439, yeah.
Okay. I'll be voting for, rather reluctantly, because I do think more time is needed. But I've heard what the Minister said and his assurances to the committee and I think the committee's job is to keep the minister's feet to the fire on the proviso, of course, that if further time is needed, because we don't know what the course of this pandemic will be, that there is the option of a further extension. So I'll be voting yes to the instrument.
Okay, thank you very much. And I will be voting yes for the instrument for the exact same reasons as has been outlined. Safety measure, which I think has to go forward with the flexibility that's been mentioned by the minister previously. Okay, thank you very much. And that means that it's 4 for the motion and 3 against. Therefore, motion number S5M23439, in the name of the Minister for Local Government, Housing and Planning, has been approved. The committee will report on this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. You happy with that? Thank you. Agenda item 4 is formal consideration of motion S5M23438, calling for this committee to recommend approval of the Draft Housing Scotland Act 2006, modification of the Repairing Standard Amendment Regulations 2020. We have just taken evidence on. I invite the minister to move the motion and speak to it if he has anything further to add.
Formally moved, convener, nothing further to add.
Thank you. I invite contributions from members. None. That's fine. Okay. The question, therefore, is that motion S5M23438, in the name of the Minister for Local Government, Housing and Planning, be approved. Are we all approved? Are we all agreed? Sorry. Are we all agreed? Sorry, I can't really see any reaction. Yes? Okay, in that case, I'm sure I'm going to get shot down here by somebody. That is agreed. The committee will also report on this instrument in due course. I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. And just to clarify, it will be a single report on both instruments. I want to thank the minister and his officials for taking part in this meeting. Members of the panel can leave the meeting by pressing the red telephone icon. I remind committee members that we remain in public for the next item. I now suspend briefly to allow for a changeover of officials and thank the minister and his officials for this morning. At item 5, the committee is taking evidence on a common framework for hazardous substances planning. Today, the committee has the opportunity to question the Minister on the outline framework in advance of writing to him with our observations on the framework earlier in the new year. Welcome back, Minister. I also welcome Ewan Page, Head of UK Frameworks Unit, Scottish Government Constitution and UK Relations Division, and Neil Langhorne, Head of Development Delivery, Scottish Government Planning and Architecture Division. Thank you for all being here today. We've allocated up to around 40 minutes for this session. There's a pre-arranged questioning order, and I will call each member in turn to see if they have any questions. If you do have any questions, I suggest you aim to complete them within 6 minutes, although there may be some latitude. I invite the Minister to now make a short opening statement.
Convener, thank you very much. I'd like to thank the committee for inviting me here today to assist in their deliberations on the provisional common framework for hazardous substance number frameworks that will come before the Parliament and is part of a programme which my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution and UK Relations, has coordinated for our interest. I'm supported today by officials from Scottish Government Planning and Architecture Division and the Constitution and UK Relations Division, which have both been involved in its production with their counterparts in London, Cardiff and Belfast. This has been a collaborative effort demonstrating cooperation and engagement between the UK administrations. This has involved a successful stakeholder engagement session and scrutiny of the draft framework by the Review and Assessment Panel. On those occasions, only minor issues were raised and considered. Overall, it was identified that this framework raised no particularly around being able to operate without any restriction in relation to devolved powers. It also agreed across all the administrations that there is little scope that would carry a market impact in this policy area. The outline framework was published in July of 2019 as an example of how common frameworks are being developed. The framework continued to make progress through the Project Board, and as the Joint Ministerial Committee for European Negotiations approved the framework in September, this is now one of the first frameworks to come before a Scottish Parliament committee. The framework has followed agreed protocols for framework development and includes agreed UK processes for making policy recommendations to ministers, as well as governance and dispute resolution arrangements. It has been developed in accordance with the Joint Ministerial Committee for European Negotiation Principles, which were agreed by all administrations in 2017. This includes the principle that the UK frameworks should both ensure the functioning of the UK internal market, as well as acknowledging policy divergence, and that they should respect the devolution settlements and the democratic accountability of the devolved legislatures. On that basis, we consider that this framework delivers against the principles agreed in 2017, and I'd be happy to take the committee's questions, but I may have to take in officials on some of the more technical aspects, Convener.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. Can I ask, just say, common framework, which I'm sure, I know it's a very technical thing, but I'm sure it must have taken a bit of work to get the four administrations to agree on a common framework. How did they go about that?
Convener, this is happening in many areas of government, as you are well aware. Officials from across the four administrations have been looking at this, but most of what is being looked at is, of course, legacy arrangements in terms of leaving the European Union. I have not been directly involved in some of these discussions, but I'm sure that Mr. Langhorne or Mr. Page could provide you with more detail of how they have gone about this with counterparts and the other administrations. Maybe take Mr. Langhorne in first, please, if that's okay, Convener.
Okay, so yeah, so it's been a collaborative process, and I think it's probably fair to say that this has been one of the simpler frameworks, simply because it's hazardous substances is not an area where there is any divergence across the administration. So it was relatively simple to reach agreement on this, and there has been very minor changes along the way to the actual wording of the framework. But there has been a series of engagements that the process, the framework has gone through a series of stages, including a technical roundtable with stakeholders to check that they were all content in March 2019, and then what's called a review and assessment panel in August 2019, and then January 2020, which involves officials from across the four administrations. So we've been feeding into that from planning, because it comes under that area. But Ewan may wish to say a bit more about the frameworks process more generally.
Thank you. Ewan?
Thank you. More generally, as the Minister and Neil have set out, this has been a collaborative process, and for hazardous substances planning, there have not been significant issues around how new arrangements might manage significant divergence between the administrations. More generally, the frameworks process was instigated in autumn 2017 with agreement on a set of principles, which the Minister has alluded to at the Joint Ministerial Committee European Negotiations. We've seen a gradual reduction in the number of overall frameworks policy areas under consideration to around 30 in total now. And the process has been marked by a commitment to proceed on the basis of agreement and not imposition by any one administration. And the Scottish Government would point to that as a productive way forward and a model for future cooperation on the practical and constitutional implications of EU exit.
Why did they go down the route of a concordat as opposed to legislation?
Sorry, Minister.
I was going to ask Mr. Page just because his screen was up.
Aye, thanks.
An assessment was made early on in the process as to whether there was a need for a statutory underpinning in any particular common frameworks area. In this area, it was recognised that beyond the necessary fixes to current legislative arrangements to ensure a continuity in a functioning statute book, there was no need for a new legislative underpinning to the hazardous substances framework. But my colleague Neil may wish to say more on the policy detail and the rationale there.
Okay, thank you very much, Neil.
Yeah, as Ewan was saying, so there was an early consideration of whether a legislative underpinning was necessary for each of the frameworks. For this one, it was decided that it wasn't, because it's essentially a continuation of current arrangement, so it wasn't considered necessary to have a legislative framework, and it would be possible through a common framework.
Okay, that's great. Thanks very much, Minister. You don't have any point to make on that?
No, I think most of it has been covered, but I think I should say that according to the Joint Ministerial Committee principles, a legislative framework should be considered only when absolutely necessary, and I think we're absolutely clear here around about the devolved responsibilities and the powers that we have here, and that's why you know, the way that this has been done creates that appropriate forum for anything to be addressed. But also we have to recognise the fact that the powers lie here.
Okay, thank you very much. I've got a question from Sarah, then Alexander.
Thanks, Convener. I want to pick up the issues about monitoring going forward. The outline framework states that relaxed hazardous substances standards would not bring a significant enough benefit to operators to influence which administration they set up business. So I'd like to hear a little bit of background about that conclusion and evidence behind it, and then ask about what monitoring is intended once this actually comes in place, just to see what's actually happening on the ground through planning applications.
I'll take Mr. Langhorne in first, please, Convener.
In terms of monitoring, what's been agreed is that there will be officials meetings every 6 months after the framework is passed to keep in touch on how things are working. We receive, obviously, details of planning applications and planning stats of how many cases and so on there are in this area. And then there is a formal review process scheduled for 2 years after the framework comes into force to see whether there is any and a necessity for any changes at that point. But yes, the stakeholder engagement around you know, whether there was any scope for divergence here. So all the way along, there's not been no concerns expressed by any of the administrations or by any of the stakeholders from both industry and local authority side that there's really any appetite for change here or therefore scope for divergence. So that's sort of been the early conclusion, and it's been confirmed through engagement all the way along that is the situation.
Let me add to that, Convener, if I may. Is that okay?
Okay. Yeah.
I think, as Mr. Langhorne has just pointed out, stakeholder engagement confirmed that there was no real appetite to change the current process and amend any limits. I should point out to the committee, and I think this is most important, the UK will still be party to relevant international agreements in this sphere. The Convention on the Transboundary Effects of Industrial Accidents and the UNECE Convention on Access to Information, Public Participation in Decision Making and Access to Justice in Environmental Matters as part of the Aarhus Convention. So this cements many of the requirements of the current regime that operates in international law. Therefore, you know, any stripping back of the hazardous substances regime would result in a breach of those international obligations. And this limits what the UK could do as party to the treaties, but of course also constrains the devolved administrations. I mean, it's right that we have signed up to all of these treaties. It is right that we have stringent regulations in place, and we must ensure, we will ensure with this framework that we continue to meet those international obligations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask a follow-up question? Will there be reporting to Parliament about those issues? Because it's clearly very much a policy lead issue within the civil service to make sure that the framework is monitored and is implemented. But I'm just thinking about, in terms of reporting back to us as the Parliament, about what's happening with the legislation and if there are any key issues that we need to be aware of or concerned of. Is there a system in place to deliver that?
Convener, I'm more than happy, as always, to keep the committee informed of any developments or any proposed changes or you know, anything else that arises out of whether that be meetings at official level or at ministerial level around about this framework. You know, it is absolutely imperative that we get all of this right, not just with this framework, but other things as well. It is absolutely imperative that we live up to our international obligations here.
Thanks, that's helpful, because I'm thinking about our constituents' safety and environmental standards being transparent. I think that's really important. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Alexander, followed by Andy.
Thank you, convener. Can I ask for an explanation as to why the informal dispute resolution process is it sufficiently robust to deal with any fundamental disagreements between administrations on the matters of hazardous waste?
In terms of dispute resolution, I think if we have Mr. Page first, who has been involved at the coal face of these frameworks, if he wants to come in first, convener, I think that would be useful for you.
Thank you, Minister. Yes, well, as alluded to earlier, the foundational approach in frameworks, in common frameworks across the piece, is to manage divergence by dialogue and agreement between administrations and not by administration. As the Minister and Mr. Langhorne have alluded, there is a fairly robust assessment that there is limited practical scope for policy divergence in this area, and the arrangements will rest on an existing scenario where there is a commonality of approach across the UK. We will continue, as the Minister has alluded to, even after EU rules fall away, to operate in a shared framework and set of constraints provided by obligations under international law. And of course, the observation and implementation of international obligations is a devolved responsibility. So, under these circumstances, both in respect of the policy matter under consideration and in respect of the general approach that's been taken with common frameworks, we're satisfied that this dispute resolution process should be sufficient. However, there is a wider point about how frameworks will operate within a reconfigured system of intergovernmental relations. And so these questions need to be bottomed out about where there might be, about potential escalation routes where matters couldn't be satisfactorily resolved within a common framework area.
Convener, if I may add to that, in terms of this particular working group on this issue, it's been in place for several years to discuss issues and to share learning, and it will continue on as a requirement of the framework agreement. That has worked well. Hopefully that will continue, you know, as I've already said to Ms. Boyack, if anything changes in that regard, I'm more than happy to let the committee know of that situation. But in all of this, I think you know, we have to recognise that in all of this, it is a devolved competence, and we have international treaty obligations to live up to and adhere to.
Thank you. Alexander.
Thank you, convener. I'm content with the responses I've had. Thank you.
Thank you. Andy.
Thanks, convener. As the Minister said, we have international obligations, and as Mr. Page said, implementing international agreements is a devolved competence, but of course, compliance and accountability for international meeting international obligations is a UK responsibility. So, where any breaches may have been identified in the past, they would be unlikely to be significant because we were living within the framework of EU law. Now, we do not have a legal framework. How would the process of negotiating and ratifying any amendments to these treaties be handled, given the UK government would be leading on that, the UK Parliament would be responsible for ratifying those? Is there a procedure built into the framework or contemplated for consultation with devolved administrations in that scenario?
I'll take Mr. Page and then I'll come in, Convener, if that's OK.
Certainly, Minister.
Thank you, Minister. Mr. Wyman raises a very important point. The frameworks process was instigated with a recognition that there would be a need for need to address a range of cross-cutting issues that would bear on the development, implementation and operation of common frameworks, the UK's future trading relationships, future economic and regulatory relationship with the European Union, and questions about how the United Kingdom as a state party to agreements under international law would fulfil those obligations and demonstrate compliance. The question of how precisely the this cross-cutting issue of international obligations is reflected in common frameworks across the piece is a matter that is still to be finalised in the common frameworks process. But there's a strong recognition that there needs to be clarity that although international relations is a reserved matter, and the UK as a whole will be the state party to future international obligations in this and other existing and future international obligations in this and other frameworks areas, the devolved responsibilities around implementation and observance of international obligations and the impact that the international obligations have on devolved policy considerations must be fully taken into account.
If I could add to that, Convener, because Mr. Wyman is correct around about the UK obviously taking the lead in terms of international agreements, but the international agreements that I've mentioned earlier are already embedded in terms of how we deal with hazardous substance planning. That will, of course, continue certainly under this government. And that is a devolved matter. Obviously, there have been concerns from various quarters around about some of the changes that may occur when we leave the European Union, or leave the transition period, should I say. And there have been concerns around about a race to the bottom. On this particular area of business, I could assure the committee that we have got very strong legislation here underpinned by those international agreements. That will continue.
Thank you. Andy?
Thanks, Convener. That's my only question.
Okay, thank you very much. That then completes today's evidence session. Can I thank the Minister and his officials for being with us today? And can I remind members of the panel to leave by pressing the red telephone icon? I remind committee members that we remain in public for the next item. Thanks again, Minister. Okay. Agenda item 6 is a consideration of negative instruments 382 and 391 as listed on the agenda. I refer members to paper number 4, which contains further detail. The instruments are laid under the negative procedure, which means that their provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul. No motions to annul have been laid. Instrument 382, the Delegated Powers and Law Reforms Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 1st of December 2020 and determined that it did not need to draw the attention of the Parliament to the instrument on any grounds within its remit. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered Instrument 391 at its meeting on the 8th of December 2020 and determined that it did not need to draw the attention of the Parliament to the instrument on any grounds within its remit either. Does anyone have any comment on the instruments? No. Okay. In that case, I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments. Does anyone object? That is agreed then. That concludes the public part of this meeting, and we will resume the meeting in private on Microsoft Teams. I propose we resume the meeting in private in 5 minutes. Please accept the clerk's meeting request for the private discussion, which will be sent shortly. You know how to exit the meeting by clicking on the red telephone icon. See you shortly.